Hey, how's it going, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Zoobox Goes to the Library. Today, Big Paul has come back. He's come back from the library, fresh from the digital library, to join me in talking about the recently released from 2021 book, Hell of a Book by Jason Mott.
Hell of a Book by Jason Mott.
This is a hell of a book.
Hell of a book.
Hell of a book.
Hell of a book.
And hell of a book.
Entertainment Weekly is already touting this as Hell of a Book as one of their heavy hitters for summer.
It's fearlessly written and constructed.
And my mind is still.
It starts off pretty funny. It's very fast paced. It's very kind of tongue-in-cheek humor.
And as you wrote in one of your answers, you've lived a lifetime as a black man in America. That's how you talked about your research and experience.
This book is very interesting because it defies genre.
As you can tell, it is a very surreal book.
And this year's National Book Award for Fiction goes to Hell of a Book, Jason Mott!
It deals a lot with black trauma and black pain. As a white person, I have a lot of privilege.
With audacity and invention, Jason Mott's Hell of a Book weaves together three narrative strands, an unnamed author, a boy named Soot, and a figure known as the Kid, into a masterful novel. In structurally and conceptually daring examinations of art, fame, family, and being black in America, Mott somehow manages the impossible trick of being playful, insightful, and deeply moving, all at the same time. A highly original, inspired work that breaks new ground.
I hope I did an okay on that one. I know that I've been trying to explain it. I loved it. So good.
What a hell of a read, my friend. Oh, hell of a book.
Indeed. Hell of a book, buddy.
So, Paul, this was Paul's choice. Explain yourself, Paul. Before we even get started about anything, so this is something you do. You have an Audible subscription.
Yes.
And you're like a fucking caveman. You don't know what's out there. You don't know what good books exist in the world.
One would say that too, or one would like to say, you know, just let fate decide. No, I'm a big gambling guy. Big gambling guy, like a little Wheel of Fortune.
Oh, you do. You probably get off on it. Like, fuck. You probably get off on it, dude.
So what happens is, I have a read like a bunch of sci-fi. I'm in, you know, the IT industry, like, if you will. So a lot of my, you know, colleagues, you know, I usually get a lot of references of, you know, the same things, right? I'm trying to like go through Dune. I keep intermittently go through Dune because that's like a 25-hour, like, you know, commitment right there too. Yeah. And but I also read, you know, just a lot of like stupid things, like, you know, the history of bourbon, and then a lot of things like, you know, within my industry, I'm reading that. So sometimes, sometimes I like to go on the main page of Audible and just scroll up, just as it's scrolling right up, and then I'll just stop. And whatever my thumb lands on, I'm going to download it and I'm going to listen to it through it no matter what. And the whole like thing about me too is like, one, it's exciting for me. I like doing stupid shit like this. I do. I get a kick out of that. And two, I'm just like, well, you know, maybe it'll force me to read something, you know,
that you wouldn't have otherwise. You know, like, it's a fair point. It's a fair point because you wouldn't. You might discover something that's really great that you never would have thought. It's like being forced to read a book in school, and you're like, well, I actually enjoy this.
Right.
But you wouldn't have chosen it anyways, right?
No, exactly. So, I mean, that was a fun thing to do. And one of these days, Sean, it will pay off. So the last time I did it, it was like a Hello from Planet Earth, and it was a sci-fi one. I was like, I did this to specifically get away from sci-fi. But like, I feel like it was written for a teenager, but whatever. That's not what this is about. This is about a hell of a book. So
hell of a book. So you did the scroll. You land on Hell of a Book.
Sure did.
He sent me a message kind of like laughing. He's like, hey, I'm going to listen to this. Would you want to listen to it and talk about it on Goes to the Library? And I was like, sure. And then I had a little thing, a little moment. I had a little problem, okay? Because I didn't have any Audible credits. Mm. And I was like, fuck, I agreed. I said I would do this. So I'm scrambling around. I'm going through other means trying to find it. Nobody's even done that. Nobody's even bothered to upload this to sites. Mm. So because I thought I was going to have to just read it. And then I found it's actually at my local library. So I was going to go and like actually just borrow the book itself, the physical book. And then I was talking to Paul on Messenger or whatever on Signal, and then I was just like, fuck it. I ended up doing that buy three credits for like $34 thing. So I could justify it. I'm like, well, I'm not spending $20 on this book.
Mm-hmm.
I'm only practically spending like $11, $12 on the book.
No, that was actually the exchange because I was just going to buy it for you. And then I looked at it, I was just like, ah.
Well, because you had already listened to it.
I'd rather that go to some lemons on DLive than
into that sweet lemon economy. Yeah. So I had to, but then I ended up just doing it and got through it this week. I actually finished it this morning for the first time and then probably listened to almost like half of it again today, like just in random parts, going back and revisiting stuff. Because I will say this, and I want to say this before we even start reviewing the book, listening to a book on Audible is much different experience than actually physically reading a book.
Oh, sure.
It's a lot easier to kind of zone out and not realize that you zoned out for like 20 minutes, and then you're like, oh, fuck, what's going on?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why I gotta listen to it like on like 205 speed, remember, because it focuses me to like...
Does it help you hone in on it?
Oh, it sure does. Absolutely.
Well, because I listened to it on, I think it was like 1.8 speed I ended up, because the guy who reads this is like fucking molasses, man. Molasses mm-hmm. on a winter's night.
Yeah.
It's very, very slow. Very, very slow. And I knew that because I went and captured a bunch of clips from the audiobook to cut in here. So I was just like, holy shit.
Yeah. But this guy that narrates it for Audible, like he's an Audible heavy hitter, and he's got like damn near like 100 titles under his belt.
A living, dude. It's a living.
No, it's a good living. And like to be fair though, too, it is a very soothing voice. It is a nice voice. There's two Audible narrators in here, but he's the main one for the main character.
Narrator for the writer. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And again, I will say this again, and this is something I also want to bring up before we start talking about it, because we just, you know, because we listened to it on Audible. A lot of this book is supposed to be a little funny. Supposed to be a lot of funny stuff. I don't think that the guy who read the book had very good comedic delivery. And I think sometimes some of the stuff fell flat because of the way it was delivered rather than the actual material sometimes.
Mm.
At least that was the sense I was getting, because I was just like, because it's supposed to be kind of madcap and goofy.
Kind of like contrast of that experience, right? Like reading versus, you know, hearing somebody else. So like you could have nailed it in your head and your internal narration. Like, oh, that was pretty funny.
Exactly.
And, you know, then someone there goes, you know, not feeling that passion in the booth, not getting that timing right, and then boom. So you know what? If like that guy ever heard that, he probably, you know what? Fuck you. I had to read that fucking book like 7 times in its entirety.
You know, actually, he probably gets paid by the minute. That's why he reads so slow. He's like, oh, how is it 326 pages? 323? Yeah. I can make this last for 10 hours.
No, I think I had found some article, but I think they have to read at a certain pace just for being able to have a high quality, being able to fast forward and whatnot.
Actually, so you might have a point there, because people do like to listen to things on like 1.5 double speed nowadays.
Or even slower, even slower. You can put this down to like, you know, 5, and then he's like, hello.
It's like taking an Ambien.
This was supposed to be a love story. And I'm like, I'm saying people get into that. I don't know.
Like an ASMR kind of thing, I guess. Maybe
something, man. You know, I had to Google ASMR when you posted that that fucking Sean versus ASMR lady.
Do not do this to me. Oh, it's awful. It's so fucking awful. Who is this for? Oh, you didn't know what the term meant?
No, I didn't know what the term meant. I found out so much shit about the internet, like everything. Like,
listen, I can't be held responsible for these things. You're an adult man, and you choose to engage.
Oh, man.
All right, so just to get into it, I'm just going to read the like little synopsis here. Or do you got anything else you want to say?
Oh, no, I was just going
to
ask you. So, like, before doing that, did you read anything else about it, or did you just,
no,
like, get the title? All right, so I did the same thing.
I didn't know anything about it. The only thing I knew is because you finished it before me, and you were laughing about having to read it and talk about it.
Yeah.
And there was even a brief moment where, like, maybe we shouldn't do this, which, you know, remains to be seen. This may never see the light of day. But I didn't know anything about it. I didn't look up the author. I didn't look up anything. I saw like the other books that he had written because it was like on the Audible page.
Mm-hmm.
He had written before this The Returned, which they turned into a series, a short-lived television series about people that come back to life after they've died or whatever.
Yeah.
Like some kind of like a resurrection type deal. And then a few other books that are escaping me at the moment. But I think the only one that was like a big hit was his first book, was The Returned.
Yep.
Like it was actually like internationally, globally, a big book. So, but this book, Hell of a Book, in Hell of a Book, an African-American author sets out on a cross-country book tour to promote his best-selling novel. That storyline drives Jason Mott's novel and is the scaffolding of something much larger and more urgent, since his novel also tells the story of Soot, a young black boy living in rural town in the recent past, and the Kid, a possibly imaginary child who appears to the author on his tour. Throughout, these character stories build and build, and as they converge, they astonish. For while this heartbreaking and magical book entertains and is at once about family, love of parents and children, art, and money, there always is the tragic story of a police shooting playing over and over on the news. Who has been killed? Who is the kid? Will the author finish his book tour? And what kind of world will he leave behind? Unforgettably powerful, an electric high wire act, ideal for book clubs, and the book Mott says he has been writing in his head for 10 years. Hell of a Book, in its final twist, truly becomes its title. Wow. That kind of gives away a lot more than I expected would expect it to.
Oh, it does. It does a little bit.
So let's just give our, what are your general impressions? You're done. You hear that. Thank you for listening to Audible.
Yeah, like in which star on the 5 line are you about to press, right? So, yeah. There were parts of it that I thought were like legitimately like enjoyable for me. I'm sure we'll talk about them like, you know, later on as we get into it. But I think overall, like the different narratives like trying to like intertwine, don't believe that was as smooth as a lot of these reviewers like would tell you that it was. And I think, and just like in general, like I said, it's like it's a very, very light read. There's not gonna be a time where you're sitting there like, you know, what does this mean? What does this actually mean? Right. So you're not gonna struggle with any literary devices here, in my opinion. It's just kind of like a little underwhelmed, and like and some of the themes too, you know, just very topical, like in our society, which I'm sure we'll also get into as well. And like and just kind of the way that was particular just kind of left me underwhelmed, and at some points kind of annoyed for reasons I'll like get into like later. So I would probably kind of hit it as like, you know, a 2.5-3 star
out of 5. You go 3.
All right, go to 3. Oh, well, just because, you know, Sean, like, you know, we're artists, man. We're artists.
Yeah, we're artists.
Even if it was crap, you know how much it took to get that crap out.
Well, that's actually something we were discussing briefly right before I hit the record button. It's like, because we watched a bunch of supplemental stuff and some interviews with the author, he seems like a very nice guy.
God. Yeah.
He, like, seems like a super nice, cool, down-to-earth guy.
Excuse me, I am a bit overwhelmed right now.
Mm-hmm. And
well, and he'll do an interview with anybody. I'm sure if you ask nicely, you know, you could probably get him on.
I probably could, honestly. I wouldn't expose him to the world of Zubox like that.
No, because he's a nice guy.
It wouldn't go good for anybody. So what did I think of it? I thought it was really kind of bad. I was totally underwhelmed by it. It's the thing. It's like, I don't read a lot of contemporary fiction. And I realized that when I was listening to the book, I was like, oh, I don't even know what the landscape is like, you know, cause when you go and you read, you listen to some of the reviews and stuff, people are like, dude, this is a revelation. This is like Kurt Vonnegut writing The Slaughterhouse Five, which is another book. It's an older, you know, kind of classic, post-apocalyptic sci-fi book that uses a lot of literary devices, a lot of literary tricks like this book does. But it's written much better. I don't know if my expectations are just so askew because I don't read any contemporary fiction.
Hmm.
Like everything the most current thing I've read like as a piece of fiction was like a Chuck Palahniuk book from like 3 or 4 years ago.
Okay.
Chuck Palahniuk, the author of Fight Club. Like that's like the most contemporary thing I've read. Cause I've been reading like old sci-fi books, like Philip K. Dick books. You know, after we did A Scanner Darkly, I ended up reading like 4 more Philip K. Dick books around that period of time.
Right.
You know, a lot of nonfiction stuff, political stuff, historical stuff. So I'm not like accustomed to it. So I don't know what the landscape is in terms of quality of writing, but I thought this was just very straightforwardly written, like the prose itself.
Right.
There's not really a lot to talk about. It's like almost like basic. And almost honestly, I thought it was a little, and I hate to say this because I thought, like I said, I thought this was a very nice guy. I thought it was a little cringy at times. Yeah. Like just the
Definitely. But just one comment, let me push on that. Like the landscape of that too, that I would just kind of counter with that really shouldn't matter, you know?
But, no, I agree with you. But I was, that was more in reference to like why people that read a lot, read a lot of contemporary stuff, why they've latched onto it. Is it because it's the subject matter and the way that this, what the story ends up being about, or is this just like how books are written nowadays?
Oh, okay.
You know, cause this is like, basically you could say you could, this is like at a seventh grade reading level, maybe.
Yeah. This could, well, yeah. It's seventh grade reading level. Yeah. But I wouldn't push it out for like, you know, content or analysis until like, I don't know, freshman.
No, no. Cause it's, it's definitely an adult book. A lot of adult stuff happens in it, but I'm saying just like the quality of the writing is pretty kind of lowbrow, which I was surprised about. And like I said, because even like, you know, like I referenced Chuck Palahniuk. Chuck Palahniuk, obviously explicit adult writer, but he has like a voice and a style that is very identifiable as his type of writing style. And it's unique and it's interesting and it's got its own tone, its own rhythm. And this just felt very anonymous. Just like I don't know, just didn't feel like the author has a very strong authorial presence as a writer in the way that he constructs sentences and the way he describes things or whatever, you know?
Well, the dragon librarian would probably disagree with you.
And my mind is still...
Oh, and I saw her, yeah.
Yeah, I hope you super clip Dragon Librarian in here right now. But as soon...
This is a very... You guys got to be careful with this one.
Yeah, but I think they would argue that, you know, it's, you know, multi-genre. You can't fit in any other genre. Maybe this one of his literary devices is to be all cloudy, especially through the lens of the narrator there. Because
we have an unreliable narrator who's this guy who you never find out his name for... whatever reason, which is never really clear. Maybe you can elucidate something for me. Because I think a lot of the cloudiness is actually doesn't serve much of a purpose. Like finding out why he has like a PTSD kind of, why he's being really aloof about what his book's about on the book tour. If you had known that information at the beginning of the book, it doesn't actually change the book very much.
No, it doesn't. And what it does is just kind of change, you know, the interplay between the two main storylines.
Honestly, yeah. Don't you think it would have been a better book if it was just more upfront? Yeah. Like if it was less of like, because it almost like has a mystery structure for no reason. Like if I actually knew what happened to Soot explicitly, if I know what happens to the kid explicitly, if I know what happens to the writer explicitly, then I can actually like empathize and like get into their characters. Cause I'll say this, having listened to it again, mostly today. And I went back and listened to a lot of the Soots, the chapters with the character Soot. I kind of left me wondering, I'm like, oh, why did you just write? Cause Soot, I assume is like an amalgamation of the writer and the kid. And that's what his second book is. Or the next book he's going to write is going to be the Soot story. Where he's going to mix his own life in with this kid who got killed by the police.
Yeah.
That's like this ghost or whatever that's haunting him.
Hey, a voice says. I turn to find a kid standing beside my table. I peg him at about 10 years old. A little gangly, meek, and nerdy looking, you might say. Like the kind of kid who spent too much time in books and not enough time grabbing life by the short and curlies. Sometimes you see kids and you just know. You can just see their entire future in their eyes. That's who this kid is. He's his entire future seen at a glance. But all of that is secondary to his skin. It's black. But not just black. He's impossibly dark-skinned. The darkest skin I've ever seen. It's like a clouded ocean sky in the dead of night. It's like burrowing into old caves where sunlight has never set foot. It's the kind of black that makes me think he's got to be wearing some sort of makeup. The kind of black that makes me question if what I'm seeing is real, or if I'm in the beginning stages of some kind of ocular or neurological crisis. His lips are moving, but I'm so startled by the color of his skin that I can't hear a word he's saying. "What was that?" I say.
"Can I sit here?"
He points to my chair and begins seating himself before I have time to give him permission. The kid has a plate of pancakes and sausage that's so much like my own, I've got to respect it. As he starts eating, I look around, trying to lay eyes on whoever it is among the rest of these fine breakfast goers that might be his parents. The last thing I want is to have some terrified parent come up to my table screaming at me about why I'm having breakfast with her son. That kind of publicity can kill a book tour. When I can't find anybody that looks like they might be the progenitor of this dark-skinned splendor, I resign myself to having met a new friend, and I jump into the same type of banter I would offer anyone else in this world. "You look like someone who's had his fair share of adventures, kid."
"Yeah, I guess," the kid says.
He keeps his eyes on breakfast as he talks, which I'm glad about because it allows me to look at the inky depths of his skin without making him feel awkward.
He black.
Mm. So do we want to get into kind of like, you know, lay out like the characters or like the organization of it?
Yeah, well, so the organization of the book is that it kind of goes one chapter is the narrator, one chapter is Soot. The Soot stuff is actually very minimal. I think it's probably about 30% of the book.
If that,
the Soot chapters are very short. But I would say actually probably more of the more interesting things, and it actually was the story that I was way more interested in spending time with. Because then you have the writer or the narrator story, which is about him, like the description said, going on a book tour to sell his book, and kind of it's almost like at times a zany, madcap, wacky adventure sometimes. Like, you know, his introduction is like running down a hallway.
Yeah, it's akin to like, you know, a rock star going on tour, you know, the way he yeah. paints out this like narrator, right? But as you're yeah. saying, you know, we're introduced to him like running buck ass naked down a hallway, and
yeah, because he's been sleeping with some man's wife.
Country. Right, right.
I'm in a hotel in the hallway. I'm running. No, actually, I'm sprinting. I'm sprinting down this Midwestern hotel hallway. Did I mention that I'm naked? Because I am. Also, I'm being chased. About 15 feet behind me, also sprinting, but not naked, is a very large man wielding a very large wooden coat hanger. Sometimes he holds it like a baton. Other times he holds it above his head like a battle axe. He's surprisingly fast for a man his size. The very large man with the very large coat hanger is draped in old navy couture, beige, straight-fit, stain-resistant khakis, argyle sweater vest, brown twill boat shoes that may or may not be faux leather. He's a family man for sure. 2.3 kids, dog named Max, cat named Princess, aquarium that's on its 12th goldfish named Lucky. He drives a Camry and lives on a cul-de-sac, in a home surrounded by a picket fence. There's an in-ground pool in the backyard. He's got a healthy 401k. He's everything a responsible adult should be. He looks to be about the same age as I am, leaving the decadent comfort of 30 and reluctantly knocking on the grizzled front door of 40. And for an instant, as the two of us sprint down this luxurious hotel hallway, feet thumping on the carpet, lungs burning, arms pumping like oil wells, I think about stopping and asking him how he built that life. How he made it all come together so perfectly. How he managed to do everything I've been unable to. I want to hear his secret. But as I take a look back over my shoulder, I see him raise that coat hanger of his into a battle axe position and shout, "My wife! That's my wife! We made babies together!"
You
please clear up the cuck article you wrote?
Yeah, he's been sleeping with some man's wife, and apparently the guy found out. That's like, you know, and then even though you spend like a ton of time with like his character, you learn a lot about Soot, I suppose, to a certain degree. They're so kind of ephemeral and archetypal that they don't ever feel like real people. I never felt a connection to any of them. I never felt like they were anything other than like caricatures.
Yeah, no character. That's one of my criticisms. No character in this novel is feels like it's ever been developed, and you can't really latch onto anything. And not only that, but in the short times you're experienced with most of them, they're just completely character, like, you know, inconsistencies that it just doesn't make more sense. I think hurts more of the story in retrospect when you're trying to reflect on like what it was about than like, helping it, right? So at some point, you know, the haziness that the narrator is like going through, because like you said, unreliable narrator, he struggles with what's in reality, you know, what's not. He's drunk all the time. Like we said, he's like a rock star going through on this book tour, right? And then that was definitely one of my criticisms as well.
Yeah. I mean, like, that was because it made it hard to invest. It made it hard to focus on the story, because so many of the characters that are introduced, like the more like kind of tangential ones, are just there to kind of be representative of part of like what African Americans have to deal with in the country and how they're treated. And part of the whole thing, they have this whole device. One of the parallels between the narrator and Soot is that Soot is taught to hide his skin. Right? His father literally says, like, you need to be unseen.
For 3 years now, his mother and father had been trying to teach him to become invisible, to become the unseen. That was the name the boy's father gave to it. He said the words with a fantastic tone. He spoke with his hands in the air, sweeping back and forth gently like he was playing some magical instrument. You will become the unseen, the boy's father said. He added an almost spooky, oh.
And then when we're introduced to the narrator, he's naked the first time. Like, there's, and they do a lot of that kind of stuff where they try to draw these kind of loose allusions between the life of Soot and the narrator's experience. And the narrator's like,
I'm sorry. And they do that so much because, like, the big reveal, I don't know if we're going to do a spoiler alert.
Yeah, go ahead.
But, like, the big reveal is that Soot is actually, you know, the narrator in there. So you do end up getting his name at the end of it, you know, well, at least his nickname from childhood was Soot. But there's so many references between his father's life, his grandfather, you know, Daddy Henry, everything where they just things that they call in. So the narrator's main vice to escape or get away from reality is trying to act like a Humphrey Bogart character, right?
So I put on my best Bogart brogue and I give it to her right down the middle. Nice set of pillars you're standing on.
This fast-paced talking. You know,
which was so just very, very, very hip African-American of the modern era.
I don't know, man. But it was annoying to hear, right? But then you hear that, like, in the Soot chapter with, you know, his dad talking about that. Hey, doll face, you know. Hey,
I got a different takeaway from the end. I thought the Soot chapters were a mix of this kid who gets killed by the police that's like haunting him, or he manifests. Because there's this whole thing at the end of the book where he's like on a talk show and he has kind of a break with reality or something. And he thinks he's talking to this dead kid's mother in this like studio of a talk show. And the dead kid's like, I want you to tell my story, like tell my story. Mm-hmm. That's what I want you to do, which is his conscious, like his subconscious telling him that he needs to write about the black experience, because there's even a moment in the book where like one of his agents or whatever is telling him, you can't write black characters, which echoes the grandfather sentiment. Like, nobody wants to hear that stuff. Nobody wants to buy that. Nobody wants to be bothered by that. So it's him coming to terms with his blackness. So I thought like the Soot thing was an amalgamation. Like, when you're reading the Soot chapters, you're actually reading the author's follow-up book. Because there are things, because I don't think that, I mean, I could be wrong. Maybe I missed something but that's what it kind of read to me at the end during the, like, kind of the big reveal. Because obviously it goes way heavier on being explicit, like, well, Soot needed medication and Soot was a writer and he would escape into fantasy worlds because he wanted his dad to be alive because his dad was also a victim of police violence. And so was, but Soot was also, wasn't he also a victim of police violence?
Yeah. With his Uncle Paul in there, and not like violence per se, but at least, you know,
well, because doesn't the story of the kid and the story of Soot merge at the end of the book? Because they're talking about Soot getting shot and how his parents, all of his parents ever wanted to do was protect him from this world.
Oh, yeah. No, I see what you're saying.
You know what I'm saying? So I thought, like, and I think it was intentionally done where he's starting to mix those two things. Like, the farther you go into the book, the more explicit they are about the kid's story.
Right, right.
Was that he started kind of mixing those things a little bit, which is honestly probably the most interesting part of the book.
The interplay between those.
Yeah. Well, I actually was kind of invested to a certain degree into the Soot story. I didn't really care about the narrator at all in terms of the way the story that was being told with him in the current time.
Yeah. So, all right. So you talk about like the Soot character archetype, right? So you just kind of, you get introduced to him through, like we said, like there's a lot of interplay between chapters, keep going back and forth between the narrator, who's not named, and then Soot, right? And then you kind of go through this whole thing with, you know, what you said off earlier, you know, the trick, the game they played at age five was, you know, to pretend to be invisible, right? And then as he goes through those rise paths, like age, the next time you pick up with, you know, like Soot is at age 10, where, you know, he's getting picked on the bus for the color of his skin.
By
his cousin too, being one of them. I think it's Tyrone in the novel.
Yes,
right?
It's Tyrone.
And the reason why they call him Soot is obviously, like, you know, Chimney. You know, he was
Chimney Soot. Dark. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But you ain't just black, nigga. You extra black. Like, I bet you sweat coffee. The first snicker rippled through the kids on the bus. I mean, why you steal all the darkness? Why you so stingy? More laughter. A few rows away, a girl yelped out a high-pitched laugh. Nigga, your mama must have been blind, and she wanted you to look like what she saw. Nigga, I bet when you get out of the car, your daddy's oil-like, come on. The snickers turned to giggles, turned to belly laughs. The entire bus was in on the fun now.
He black. And they go there, and it kind of falls down too. So what about the narrator's arc, right? So like everything about this, like you get introduced to him, like running, he's running naked from, you know, sleeping on someone's wife, and he runs into an elevator, and then immediately thinks as he gets into the elevator, you know, this old lady like basically saves him. Saves the elevator door open for him so he can get in there in time before the guy catches him. So he's butt-ass naked going down the elevator talking to this old lady. And then this is the first time they reference this, and this will happen like throughout the rest of the book. Did you hear that boy? Did you hear about that boy?
Yes.
All right, and it goes on. So it's like subconsciously getting you at the beginning, or well, not subconsciously. It's like planted right there, like in the beginning it is in your face. And then he moves back on to like the character, which you find out is like a defense mechanism of living in this kind of blurred reality, right? And as he's going down there and then just saying, like, I have no idea what she's talking about, what kid, and I'm sure there's, like, another one, but I just, you know, nod my head and say, damn shame, because that's what a good person does. And it just his – right off the bat, he does paint out, like, this great lack of understanding of, like, reality, right? So you already see he's, like, more so if you're worried about what's a good person – then why are you naked in the first place running down the hall, right?
I think it almost presents him as a narcissist and a sociopath, except the way they explain it away, it's like, oh, his mother died, and that really affected him in a big way.
Yeah.
Because he, you know, I don't see, this is the thing, like, it's, and I listened to some interviews, and he did not have this completely planned out. He actually, the first draft of this book is just about the book tour. It's just a goofy comedy about being on his, it was like kind of a semi autobiographical about him on his first book tour.
Right.
And then it just sat on a shelf forever, and he would go back to it every once in a while. And then during quarantine, he finishes the book, which I think is where we get the socio-political angle And he, yeah. I think he added all that stuff in there
to
change the book. But the book just feels like it's really all over the place, like tonally. And I understand that some of that was his intention, was to have, but I just don't think it worked very well most of the time. Like you get like real tone whiplash like constantly. And I don't, it just didn't work for me very well at all. Like where you have like guys like having a slap fight because he's too drunk to go into this book reading he's supposed to do, and then a BLM protest busts through the middle of the street.
Our own slapstick chaos is broken up by a chaos of another sort. Down the street, Rennie and I both hear a maelstrom of voices rising and falling in rhythm. The air around us suddenly feels 10 degrees warmer, as if whatever's coming is sending energy out in front of itself. It's the type of thing that you wouldn't think could be real, but it is. I know it's real because I can see it in Rennie's face. He's looking in the direction of the sound, with just as much confusion as I feel. And not only is he confused, my friend Rennie looks a little scared. Something's coming. Something epic and important and potentially terrifying, potentially life-changing. I can feel it in my stomach. Or that could just be the vodka. But no, turns out it's not the alcohol. Little more than a block away, a wall of people suddenly emerges from a neighboring street. They carry signs and banners. They shout and chant and punch fists at the overcast sky as though it's done something to offend or condemn them. They're all kids, not a single adult mixed in among the bunch. The oldest among the mass looks like he just walked away from 16 last week. The youngest is in diapers and still sucking on an insulated bottle. But regardless of their age or wardrobe, they're a force to be reckoned with.
And then we spend 20 minutes talking about BLM.
Yeah.
And then they go back to having a slap fight. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's not balanced very well. And he couldn't find the comedy, like the absurdity in what was happening to him at that moment was not like incorporated into the story very well, like organically. Like right. if you have a drunk guy who's like vomiting all over himself, and his handler has to slap him around to get him to wake up, and they just stand and watch this protest walk by and be very observant and very like respectful. Mm-hmm. Like there wasn't a way we could have incorporated into this, into some of his denial, his self-destruction. You know what I'm saying? Like, cause if the book is about identity, about accepting who you are, accepting your trauma and your pain and your lot in life to a certain degree so that you can actually move on from it. Those things were not like incorporated in a way that felt meaningful at all.
No.
Only in the most cheap, like kind of cynical way. Like, that's what I mean. It's very like surface level. It's like he was, you know, obviously aware of current events and what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And even name drops. I mean, even George Floyd is mentioned in the book.
They hold up poster board photographs of Emmett Till and Tamir Rice, Michael Brown, Philando Castile, George Floyd, and all the other names that will be added to America's list between the time I write this and the time you read this.
So it just doesn't seem like it was just a very, like he didn't have a good idea of what he was almost ultimately trying to express, because it just seems there to be like I said, like cynically, emotionally manipulative.
Mm-hmm.
In a way that I think when you see the response of like some of the people that have really been heaping praise on it, it almost feels like, and I hate to say this, it almost feels like the subject matter is just something that you really can't criticize.
Yeah.
Just because it's in there.
No, for sure. I would say on a side note, the most fun part of this was looking up reviews and videos of people talking about it for that same reason.
Which is crazy. This is a New York Times bestseller, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
It's won a few awards.
Yep.
And I don't know. It was on the Today Show. If you go to the Today Show's official YouTube page, like 7 million subscribers, the interview they do to promote this book has like 2,000 views.
Oh, wow.
Like nobody's talking about it except for these few people. And if you find those other reviews, they're like, you know, they're doing solid Zoobox numbers. 30. Yeah. 90. So
yeah, Yeah, but I didn't want to like side like track too much like off of that. But it just the main narrator's arc, I think, is what like frustrated me the most about that, because there was definitely, I felt like, a lot of potential to do something with that. Just with that setup, right? I mean, you could say that about anything that you don't like. You know, there's potential to go somewhere else, right? But I just think, in particular, you know, like, I like that idea of, you know, a rock star, but it's like a book tour and like a losing grip of reality, kind of like, you know, Fear and Loathing type of thing, you know, generally, that's something I would generally be really, really interested
in. It's like Fight Club for social justice.
And, you know, and that's so many like it's hints pedantic, of that too,
it's
right?
pedantic to say that, but I mean,
yeah,
it is. Kind of was.
No, but you're not wrong, because like the main narrator, his whole story as part of this novel is essentially an allegory for becoming woke. And mm-hmm. it does it in the most anticlimactic way. Like the entire novel, you're reading for something to happen, and then nothing does. And then and the thing, when you get to the point, you know, the parts of the novel that were, you know, was the event, so to speak, there was already so much on the nose, like sometimes like leading up to it, that you're just, oh, okay. Like case in point, like, you know, the Denver interview, right? Like it was, and like that was about that. I think the most exciting it got was right from his introduction and like running down the hallway naked. So,
well, that's what I mean. Like you said, there is kind of, you see the potential and you see how things could, it's like, maybe he needed another two or three drafts or something. Cause it just feels, a lot of that stuff feels shoehorned in there. Like I said, it's not delved into very deeply at all.
Right.
Like, I'm sorry, but like, if you're telling a story and you're like, hey, feel bad that a kid got shot by a cop. Like, hey, no problem. I can feel mm-hmm. bad that a kid got shot by a cop. Don't you worry.
Right.
But I don't know anything about this kid. I don't know anything about what happened, what's going on, what's the larger context. And then you see, and he goes throughout the book, because a lot of the characters, like I had said before, kind of serve the purpose of like giving him some sort of barrier to overcome, right. Some sort of dilemma, some sort of thing to show him why he's like low-key being microaggressed against all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, obviously one of the most egregious ones would be like the agent who's like, don't write black stories.
Jack,
which I think,
Jack, the media, media trainer.
One last thing though. What's that? This probably goes without saying, but I'm going to say it anyway. Don't write about race. Specifically, don't write about being black. You can write about black characters, but just don't write about being black. No. Why not? Trust me on this. I've crunched the numbers. I've seen a dozen writers like you come and go. You've got that crossover talent, my man. You live in both worlds. That's the smartest thing about hell of a book. You need to hang on to that. The last thing people really want to hear about is being black. Being black's a curse, no offense, and nobody wants to feel cursed when they read something they just finished paying $24.95 for. Know what I mean? Here's one thing I've learned. When someone treats you terribly, the last thing they want is for you to behave as if they've treated you terribly. If I punch you in the neck, I don't want you bringing up that time I punched you in the neck. It's your job as the punchy to grin and bear it and treat me like I never did it. Make me feel good. Help me forget the whole neck-punching adventure. It's common courtesy, really. And that's just the same for the person who said they loved you and then showed it not to be true, as it is for the country that kidnapped you and chopped off your left foot. Nobody wants their monstrosities brought up. And if you should happen to do it, they'll hate you for it. Just ask Frankenstein's monster. Say what?
Yeah. Like no, absolutely.
People want to hear this stuff, and then he does that word salad of just like vomiting out like all of these like woke terms.
The future of this country is all about patriotic, unity-inducing language. Post-racial, trans Jim Crow, epi-traumatic, alt-reparational, omni-restitutional, jingoistic body positive, socio-cultural transcendental, indigenous ripostic, Treaty of Fort Laramie perpendicular, meta-exculpatory, pan-political, uber-intermutual, MLK-adjacent, demi-Arcadian bucolic. That is the vernacular of the inclusive hyphenated Beau American destiny we're manifesting here, you and me. Book by book, we're making it happen. But it doesn't happen by planting flags and picking at the scabbed over wounds of a certain dispossessed neo-global cultural demographic committed at the hands of a one-time, possibly improprietous proto-nation. It's such a beautiful word soup he's feeding me. Simply beautiful.
Mm-hmm. What I said earlier about, you know, the inconsistencies, like in the characters too, so Jack, the media trainer, is like a great point. And then his publicist, Linda, in there, right? So like, hang on this one here for a second. So when they're getting, his publisher is getting Jack, the media trainer, in here, they're doing this to gear up, you know, for interviews, to step up, the sales are doing great and everything in there, you know, because they annoyingly talk about some random statistic about what affects, you know, book sales or whatnot.
Yeah.
And then, so when Jack, the media trainer, meets the narrator for the first time, he's like, oh, you didn't tell me you're black. And then Linda goes, well, I wanted to see if you'd be able to tell. I couldn't. Well, this is great. And he goes, why does that matter? He's like, oh. And then he goes into this whole thing that don't do this, right? And then Linda's comment to that, when the narrator says, why does that matter? He goes, see what I'm working with here, Jack? Like this, you know, the quiet thing that you're not supposed to say out loud, right? But they said out loud, and this whole thing, like, oh, you don't do this, right? And then, like you said, the word salad of, here's why, you know, you don't do that, right? And, you know, this will hurt sales and blah, blah, and this and that and the other. But what happens, like later on, so after they go this whole thing about, don't talk about that, then all of a sudden Linda, the publicist, you know, hears about another story, and she's just so shook and disturbed, like, how is this going to happen? Then Jack, the media trainer, is like, oh my God, when is this going to happen? So it's gone this like quick quip about like gun violence. Like, what do we even need guns for? You know,
God. Then,
like, it's just so like really, cause you just painted them off as like, you know, these cold, heartless, like get to the point about sales. And all of a sudden now you're going to really, like, they give a shit. Like, give a shit. The only one thing I would make it really, like, if you comment on this would improve sales. Like, I would have appreciated that more than, like, you know, how it.
Well,
did
I think it's it probably just... it's probably there. I guess if I were to be charitable, is to say about like the faux sincerity people have about the struggle of the black community, because they'll virtue signal about gun violence while in the same sentence also be like, well, don't present black. Don't present black, which. Oh, by the way, Jason Mott, he's a very straight-laced dude. Like, he's not like a, I don't know what you'd call it. Like, he's not very urban. And I'm not saying that as like a negative or anything, but relative to what they're talking about in the book and who he is as an author and as a person, how he presents himself. It's just like, I guess maybe that is the thing with those characters. That you could just be like, well, even though he's like that, even though he's so straight laced, he's like, you know, white for, you know, white presenting, whatever you want to call it.
I think a great way to relate this to is that movie, Sorry to Bother You, right? When you go in the Danny
actually, Glover. Dude, I thought about that movie a lot while reading this, because the pace and the style and the tone seemed like he was trying to do that with the, when you were, especially when you were spending time with the narrator.
Yeah, exactly. So I felt that was like their here's your white voice like scene, right?
Yes.
The problem with that is, you know, it's like, well, it was already done before, and that one, at least it was, you know, somewhat funny. And like David,
I hated that fucking movie.
Patton Oswalt like doing their voices, whatnot.
I hate that movie. Commie gobbledygook.
No offense, but it sounds like some fucking commie gobbledygook.
That's what that fucking movie was. All of his friends hate him because he decided to like try at work.
Mm-hmm.
Ridiculous.
No, it is. For another time. But I was in it for that Animal Passion. So.
Oh yeah, I bet you were. Yeah, Army Hammer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, buddy. But yeah, no, I mean that was just bad. And then what was it? The other character too. It was like Rennie, which was his handler. Like when he got to one of those states, right? He just described them as like, what was that famous Asian actor, Johnny Wong? He said it looked like Johnny Wong,
yeah,
or whatnot. And then apparently he went to Harvard and used to ride in limos, but now he drives them, and that was never explained. There's like a subtle hint that this guy is like well off.
Yeah, because he lives in a mansion. There's not even a subtle hint. They go to his house.
Right, right. Well, yeah, but like, there's nothing over there. And then the guy, you know, and all of a sudden, like Rennie has, like, he's the one like slapping him, like what you're referencing earlier. Like,
yeah,
ready to go to the next area. And then they see, you know, there's protesters going by. And then he gets all like, you're going to tell me the guy, like, you described as Johnny Wong, and, like, you know, like this businessman, whatever, is going to have like strong feelings about you need to go out there and talk about the black condition, which, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, it was just like, I don't know.
Well, that's why, like, a lot of it just doesn't read as very, like, credible. It just seems very contrived, right? Like, it's everything. It's author insert stuff where it's just like, well, I'm not a
fan. I'm not a fan of like trying to use like straw man like arguments every time. Oh. And every time there was a, I already know what that yeah. O is going for. But every time that there's like a, you know, a contrast or something to his like inner thoughts, like come to terms with, you know, like what the narrator says, you know, his blackness or, you know, like what's happening on like in the world. Every opposing thought of that is just the most like stereotypical, like just like I said, like a freaking straw man in there. Yeah. And just also made like insincere too. It's just like you're not looking to persuade anything. Well, if you are, you're failing, you know, badly, because you're,
well, it's because it's made for people that already agree with whatever like the general sentiment is, right?
Right.
That's what it is. Like, it's about like, well, you know, you're reading this book, you're probably like a woke cool person. Sure. I don't need to talk about the politics of any of this stuff. I just have to present it, and you're like, yeah, that's true, of course that's true. Mm-hmm. I guess the most egregious straw man was the ex-cop that he talks to towards the end of the book.
Yeah.
And where he is just like this ball of stereotypes of like angry, impotent white men.
Don't pretend you don't know why. Don't pretend like you ain't never had the thought. Don't pretend like you don't sit around sometimes being angry, chewing your cud, like my daddy used to say, over everything that's been done in this country to people like you. People like me. Black people, you're angry, and why shouldn't you be? But the thing about it is, I didn't do it. I didn't do any of it. I wasn't born when all of that slavery shit happened. I wasn't even a twinkle in somebody's eye. And you weren't never a slave. You weren't never nobody's property. Me and you, we went to the same school, grew up just as broke. We live the same life, but I get to carry around all of the guilt. I get to be called an oppressor. I get to be told about how everything my ancestors did was terrible. Well, how do I know? How do you know? Wasn't neither of us there? Not you nor me. So how you know that my folks owned slaves? How do you know that my folks had anything to do with hurting and harming your folks? And yet you still want to blame me for it. You want to blame me just because you're angry about stuff that you can't control. I ain't gonna sit here and say that your people ain't had a bad shake. I won't say that. But they're all dead. All the ones that it happened to, they're all gone. And now everything's fair. Everybody's got a chance at things.
Mm-hmm.
Type feelings. He even says to him at one point, I was just angry. Yeah, maybe I was angry when I shot that kid. Maybe I was angry because you people have everything that I was supposed to have, that was supposed to be promised to my people.
So yeah, maybe I was a little mad when I came across that boy. I saw him, and I saw people like you, people that got to have the things that were supposed to be promised to me.
And you're like, what the fuck?
What the fuck are you talking about? Yeah.
Like, this is odd. And it's just there to make a point. It's not there to be realistic. And I guess, you know, if he wanted to, as a defense, I'm sure the author could be like, yeah, it's surreal. Like, it's magical. It's like, mm-hmm. he's going on an odyssey, a magical odyssey. It's not really, it's like Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. Some of the stuff is metaphor. And like we said earlier, like the narrator is unreliable. So who knows if these are really happening, or are these just thoughts in his head, like the conversations he's having with himself.
Yeah, I don't know, get, and I'd really like would back that up if there was like some type of, I don't know, like profound like outbreak, right? Because how does it start? Like, and you know, this, keep in mind, first and foremost, this is supposed to be a love story, and you know, and so like there's everything about it was just like you said earlier, just kind of like cringe, and then just a lot of despair, right? So, like we said, like the Jason Mott, you know, as nice of a guy as he, like, he seemed, at least, like, all the interviews and everything, it just, like, it looked like a cool guy. I actually tried to go pull up some of his, I guess he wrote a lot of poetry as well.
Yeah.
In addition to novels, what I want to, I'm curious to go, like, check some of those things out. But, oh, where the fuck was I going with this? You see? Hell of a book, man. Hell of a whirlwind, man. It gets me. Gets me all out of sorts. But as it ends, though, like, despair is, like, one of, like, main themes. Like, whether it's the preacher he sees talk, you know, when he's doing the inner narration for, you know, so it's father, right? I think the Uncle Paul, like, character in there, mm-hmm. huge, like, care of that. And then, like, everything, you know, it's just, like, despair and leaning. So there's no, like, positive message.
Well, no, there isn't, because, like, when he starts to come to terms with the fact that he's black, right? That he's mm-hmm. a black writer, and that should mean something to his work. Because, a writer, an artist, they should be speaking themselves, like, their lives. They're representing sure. something of themselves in their art, and by not representing your blackness, then you're being inauthentic. But when you think that the book should be kind of coming to some sort of conclusion or crescendo, and when he starts coming to these conclusions about, you know, his blackness or whatever you want to call it, then the book is just like, yeah, you know, there's nothing you can do, you're black, you're always going to be a victim. Like, they literally, like, just say that. There's, like, a monologue where mm-hmm. actually I think the dragon librarian lady read it in her review.
Oh yeah.
Happy? No, I'm not sure black people can be happy in this world. There's just too much of a backstory of sadness that's always clawing at their heels. And no matter how hard you try to outrun it, life always comes through with those reminders letting you know that, more than anything, you're just a part of an exploited people and a denied destiny. And all you can do is hate your past and, by proxy, hate yourself. Being who we are, it's hard. We get shot or put in jail. It's all we see. It's all we know. Our whole story is about pain and loss, slavery and oppression. It defines us. It seeps into our skin. We bleed it even as we're covered by it. All we want is to be something other than the pain that we have been born into. All we want is to be known for something else. We want the great history we see in others. And all we're ever given is the story of being in pain and being forced to overcome.
Where it's just like buzzword, 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 mm-hmm. buzzword about just you are a victim. There's right. no escaping that. You're just born a victim. There is no real way out of it. That's the thing. I don't even know what the fuck the point of the end of the book is, other than just like, yeah, be who you are and be your authentic self.
Right. And again, you listen to, like, interviews with, you know, Jason Mott out there, and he says, like, you know, who's this intended reader for, right? It's like anyone that's, you know, get tired of the news and seeing, like, these types of killings, or wants to know how to, I think he said, wants to know how to, like, interact with BLM or what they're all about, which was really, really interesting to me, because, like, I don't think he knows what BLM is all about, right? So, like, you and I agree, BLM as a sentiment, yes, understand, like, 100%.
Yeah.
BLM as an organization, right? I think they would have a lot to say about, you know, Soot's nuclear family.
Well, this is what I'm saying. Well, this is what I'm saying about, like, the depth of the argumentation is that it's not there, because he's just like, well, I mean, I'm sure this is not a conscious thing. I'm sure he wasn't just being flippant about it, but, like, I'll include it there and people will just agree with it. People will just not think anything of it, and they'll just be like, oh yeah, this is a very serious, solemn moment. Isn't this so interesting?
Really, all the woke aspects of this, and I hate, like, that I know that term, or I use it, I'm using it now, but, like, all the woke aspects of this in this novel, like, to me, seem, as somebody took a stab at, you know, doing some writing, you know, one time before, but
yeah,
just seemed like a complete afterthought. Everything.
Kind of
just seemed like an afterthought.
When I found out that he had written a draft of this that was just the book tour stuff, I was like, oh, that makes a lot of that makes way more sense.
Mm-hmm.
I suddenly kind of a lot of it clicked with me that I was just like, oh,
yeah,
that it does. It feels like you have grafted other things onto a different book.
Yeah, and like the other critique I have too is just like it. like if he dialed back a lot, like, because you could, I still think, like, with, even if it came across as like an afterthought, if that's how you wanted to do it, I think if you made it even more subtle and less on the nose, it'd be more powerful or something to reflect
on,
just like anything else, right? But it, the fact that it's just, it gets all spelled out and like,
yeah,
before you do it, and it's just,
I know we've talked about this before, in movie reviews and stuff. There's nothing I dislike more than when the subtext is just told to you.
Just let it lie. It's not told to you, it's just slapped to you in the face. If you're reading it, then it's going to get slapped on your face, just like Jack Meteor, Jack the Media Trainer's word soup, right? So,
So, should we talk? Let's talk about Soot and his family. What did you think of the Soot sections? Did you find those like engaging, interesting? Because I thought, like, in my opinion, I was like, well, there's actually something here.
Cool. No, I thought that at the beginning, I thought he wrote a very like warm, nice descriptive of Soot's father. I think it was nice. I was legitimate, like laughing. It was like, ah, find another little ankle biters. You know, I mean, it was just like, you know, typical like dad shit, whatever. I thought that that was nice. I am in kind of agreement with you too. I was more drawn towards that Soot subline, but that's, you know, really, but I think I think that that part Soot's like, you know, tragedy, ongoing tragedy, like what's happened with his father, and then, you know, his angry uncle coming in to help him and get him exposed to situations, because like he's as it says right there, like, you know, I'm going to give you a gun. I think he's like 12 at this point.
Yes.
When his father dies. And then,
yeah, when his father does.
You know, and then his uncle is going to get, like, here's a gun. You're going to need. I'm like.
Well, because the whole thing is about, like, that side of the story, which is, I know that's also what he's trying to draw parallels to in the narrator's story as well. It's about, like, intergenerational trauma and how other generations have dealt with being black, right? Like, you know, it goes from the grandfather, the uncle, the father. And there's a lot of actual substance to their relationships that's inferred by their interactions. Like, as kind of ham-fisted as it was, like the scene where, you know, Soot's father, or Jimmy, I think, right? Jimmy decides basically, like, well, I'm never going to talk to my father again, and you're never going to see my son again, because you're a poisoned person, basically.
I need you to be happy the way your daddy used to be, boy. I need to know that you won't fall apart and give up on things like he did.
Daddy Henry's eyes flitted from his son to his grandson.
I'm trying to help, he said, staring at Soot. I hear you like stories, Daddy Henry said. That's good. There's a future in that. You should take up writing. But you gotta tell the right stories. You gotta tell them the right way. No nigger stories, okay? You gotta do it right.
His face contorted with each word. It transformed from worried to angered to pleading until it finally settled on a type of sad resignation.
Please, he said. Let me help him. Please.
Say goodbye, Soot's father said.
Goodbye, Daddy Henry, Soot said.
With tears running down his face, Daddy Henry made a move to get up out of the chair, but his legs failed him. He pulled with his arms at the edges of the chair, trying to pull himself free of the prison that was his body, but that failed as well. As he left, Soot watched the old man continue to struggle against the weight of his infirmity. He raged and fought, but remained pinned by gravity to his chair.
And to learn a little bit about why Jimmy's father feels the way he does about himself, about being black, about the whole thing about being unseen. All of this stuff is obviously from the influence of his grandfather, because he just took the most like negative thing he could from what the grandfather or what his father was saying to him. There was actually some interesting stuff there, and it was in the subtext.
Yeah.
I mean, it's obvious, but it's at least it was in the subtext, and there's interesting, there's interesting things to actually like kind of latch onto emotionally. And things that you can understand.
Sure.
Like, it's really hard to empathize with a fucking, like, sociopath, like, writer bouncing around the country being depressed and not having anything interesting other than he's just being fucking depressed.
Yeah, being depressed, went on a couple dates and then found Boss Kelly. Because that was this thing, right? Yeah, every girl, his name was Kelly, and then there's one and she's like a mortician or some shit. But anyways, but yeah. back on Soot though, like
that's a love story.
Yeah, no, it's a love story. But the another goddamn afterthought. Daddy Henry?
Yeah, Daddy Henry.
His grandfather, right? Like, so I was talking about Strawman earlier, like with the ex-cop. There's another like Strawman thing, like with a cop that confronts Suit's Uncle Paul. But then about Daddy Henry, though? Man, that was like the most Uncle Ruckus
character. Uncle Ruckus, or it's kind of like Uncle Ruckus or Bernie Mac from Don't Be a Menace. South Central while drinking your juice in the hood.
Hate you black bastards. You stink. I hate your black skin. I hate your black pants. I hate black pepper. I hate black keys on the piano. I hate my gums because they black. I hate Whoopi Goldberg's lips. I hate the back of Forrest Whitaker's neck. And most of all, I hate that black ass Wesley Snipes.
Yeah, yeah, just totally like you draw them white people. You draw them white people.
Yeah.
You're good at it. You make that money.
You see this? Isn't this the most beautiful white woman you ever seen drawn?
Ever.
Like it laid it on very thick. But there are people that are like that too, though. You know, and the reason actually it reminded me a ton. I don't know if you've ever seen it, and I was like, oh, it feels like you kind of stole some of this from August Wilson. Have you ever seen Fences? Denzel Washington.
No. That's one of the ones that's on the queue. Never got. Yeah,
Denzel Washington made a movie out of this famous play by August Wilson called Fences, and the father son dynamics, the family dynamics of the Soot stuff, is very much reminded me, very reminiscent of Fences, because it's all about this, fathers feeling the failures of their life, feeling stuck, trying to get their sons to not do that, but also wanting their sons to achieve the dreams that they never accomplished, and the kind of rage that can make a person feel, and how that can get all fucked up, right? Mm-hmm. And I thought that kind of stuff was in those sections of the book. And that was the stuff that I was the most engaged by, just even in a vacuum. Even if I had just read Soot's story as like a short story, I would have walked away being like, oh, it was interesting. You know, that was all right.
Yeah, no, there's worse things to, spend your time reading, right? But back on the narrator, like, did anything do it for you? Like that whole like main through line?
Dude, I just didn't know him. Because like we talked about before, they use his life as like this onion. You're supposed to be unpeeling and learning these new little bit by bit. You learn little new things about his life that's supposed to inform what has come before. But the stuff that has come before is so forgettable that it's like I was struggling to like make the connections that the author clearly wanted me to make with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I almost, like I said, I wish it was just more straightforward. I think the whole thing about him having this disorder that like he can't discern reality from his imagination, I thought was just like useless.
I've got a condition. I've got several conditions, actually. The most interesting one is this thing I got where my mind runs away with itself. It's like daydreaming, except it doesn't really go away when I want it to. It lingers. Sometimes people call it a disorder, but I'm a glass half full kind of guy, so I don't go in on that dime store wordage. Basically, I'm a daydreamer. But my daydreams tend to persist longer and more intensely than most people's do. At least, that's what I've been told by every doctor I've ever seen. The end result of it is that reality is a very fluid thing in my world. It's probably the reason I got into this whole writing thing to begin with.
You could have done the same thing and just had him with a nagging conscience about his own blackness and this story with this kid who's being shot, everybody asking him, what's the next story you're going to write, man? While they have all the stuff going on in the background of people like encouraging him to write about black stories, other people telling him not to, him having kind of a crisis of identity, and what does that mean, and how do I work through those things? And you could even end it in a similar way, except just do it straightforward, where he's on a talk show and he ends up being on a panel with the mother of the kid that got shot. And that's the thing, that he talks to her. It humanizes the experience. He thinks about his own life, his own traumas, because that's what the book is trying to do. It just does it with all of this extra shit that serves almost no fucking purpose. It didn't make it more engaging or interesting.
Yeah,
it was just distracting. It felt filler. It's all very superficial.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, if you had just done this way more straightforward, I think you actually just have a better story, in my opinion, you know?
Sure. Yeah, I don't know, man. Like, everyone's experiences are, you know, are different, and everyone's got different perceptions of, you know, their reality based on what they grew up, right? Like, your buddy Tim Poole on the south side of Chicago is going to have a different perspective on a lot of certain lives than, you know, us in the sticks in New England, right? But I just a lot of it, too, it's just like really topical with that, and I think it really relied, and not to shit on like anyone's hard work and whatnot, but I think it got all this praise because it was like, it's so topical. If you sit down and like you were to break that out and try to abstract that from the novel and just try and look at what literary devices are using, like what are the themes here, like what was the story that they're trying to convey, what is it? Because that's what I, after like listening to it 1.5 times almost, you know, myself. Like, I still, like, you know, you're struggling, like, with identity. You know, like, there's definitely, it doesn't end well. Not everything has to end well. He even comments on it, you know. It's, you know, it's okay if nothing ends well, right? What's the last chapter? Like, so everything's fixed, right? Like, yeah. No, it's not. So it's just, like, where do you go? Like, what is supposed to be the healthy, like, take out of this? And I get it. And I'm not saying every story's got to have, you know, a positive message ended in
it. Of course not. But it should feel coherent. Like, you should walk away like understanding what the thesis statement of the book is. And other than that, then like, be your authentic self.
Yeah.
Because it's, you know, it's obviously about what is it like to be a black man in America through the prism of being a writer and that industry and the working in the arts and working in popular culture, that you are somehow encouraged not to be black. Which, I don't know if this guy, maybe this guy's just not very familiar with pop culture from the past 30 years. I don't know. I mean, because, dude, oh my God, there's even a reference. I mean, he just, the first time they go through maybe this is his age talking. I don't know how old he is. I think he's in his late 30s, maybe in his 40s. There's a very, when they have the BLM parade, protest, somebody's dressed up like characters from Do the Right Thing.
Then come the Boombox Boys dressed in red, black, and green, four of them. Late teen, muscle-bound fellows with radios on their shoulders and fight the power blaring from their boombox speakers. All of them wearing four-finger gold rings across their fists. L-O-V-E and H-A-T-E on one pair of black hands. G-E-T-M and O-N-E-Y on another. And the third somehow impossibly reads, "See me as human, nigga."
Radio Raheem. Radio Raheem's the character who walks around with a boombox, and he's got like these two knuckle rings that say love and hate. Those are in the colors of the African flag.
Right.
Because he spends a lot of time just talking about the way they look.
Yeah.
And you're like, I get it, dude. I got it. Mm-hmm. I got it.
Yeah.
You could have just said big black guys with a boombox, and I would have got it. Like, you didn't have to go so far as to put them in the Radio Raheem costume. But that's just another thing about it, just being so surface level.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a surface level experience. Nothing is talked about with any great depth. Like, if you don't already agree with the sentiment, there is no argument made.
Right.
So you're just like, here's a statement.
Right,
here's a statement. You agree with it. I don't have to push back on this at all, right? I don't have to get into the complicated nature of any of this stuff.
Right.
Especially like if there was an opportunity to do it, it would have been with the cop who shot that kid.
Mm-hmm.
That conversation.
Yeah.
Actually have like a weird difficult, real conversation. Instead, the cop is just like the most stereotypical angry, secretly angry white guy, because he's supposed to represent the tone and tenor of the country for white people. At least that's what it felt like.
Yeah.
Was I being personally attacked, Paul?
I think you were.
Oh my God. Well, I've never even been a cop. You've been in the military. You should be feeling attacked, you piece of shit.
I think if you're feeling attacked, then this book was for you.
No, I was just kind of rolling my eyes. I'm like, it starts off like it's going to be like this interesting, maybe like a conversation, maybe for the first time in the book. Like they're going to maybe get down to the meat of something. And it's just like, oh no, he's just an evil guy. He's just a bad guy. Like, it doesn't try to represent the complicated nature of the people that get wrapped up in these things and being on either side of an event like that.
Right.
And what that could possibly mean and how complicated and weird and the darkness of that for everybody involved.
Right. You had an opportunity to go into like really on like an action opportunity, like to make it like a, you know, Raiders Like Us or, you know, everybody like, you know, like uncomfortable or have like those conversations. Did you feel uncomfortable at all? Like as you're going through this?
No.
And not uncomfortable as like cringe, but just like the topic in general.
Like it touched me in a way that I was like, oh wow, that's an interesting point. I never really thought of that. Like,
Inconvenient truth, some might say.
Which, in full transparency, if it had, I would admit it. I'm a very open, honest person. Like, that's the whole point of doing these kind of things. That's the point of reading a book like this, or reading any book, or doing any of this stuff, or watching a movie, or listening to music. If it actually had affected me in that kind of way, I would totally be transparent about it. I have no problem, like, having this conversation, or learning more about it, or trying to be more empathetic to things that I don't fully understand.
Well, that, in essence, right, is the goal, is to evoke some type of emotion, right? And
I felt bad for Soot when Tyrone was giving him a hard time.
Yeah, that sucked. That sucked.
I felt bad for Soot's dad when his grandfather couldn't let it fucking go.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just probably more for just personal life, my personal life.
Yeah.
You know, my father and my grandfather have had weird conversations like that in front of me when I was a kid. So I was just like, oh, okay. I connect with that. Me as a young black identifying man.
He black.
Yeah. Well, you are in South Kakalaki. Well, that's one thing, too. It's like the author, too. So, I mean, obviously, Stephen King always writes about, you know, being in New England and some of the characters based on Maine, there. Right? So it doesn't matter. But, this author is from Bolton, North Carolina.
Which is
exactly where the narrative is from.
Nestled in the sweaty armpit of Carolina swampland, surrounded by gum trees and pines and cedars and oak and wild grapevines, the town of Bolton is the land that time forgot. Go back far enough into the town history, and there used to be a railroad stop and a sawmill here. And that was at its pinnacle, somewhere around 60 years ago or so. Back then, the town had a population of maybe around 3,000 people. The main exports of Bolton are lumber and black manual labor. The wood comes from the forests and swampland, all of which are owned by the local paper mill, and the labor comes from the town's 700-odd residents. I wish that I could tell you that something more than those two chief exports comes out of Bolton, but there's nothing else. Bolton isn't a town that gives, but neither is it a town that takes. It's the type of place that keeps to itself. It's self-sustaining, the way the past always is. And though it changes a little now and again, the way an old piece of metal seems to change colors over the years as some thin patina comes along and begins to grow over it, at its core, the town is the same that it has always been. And that's how the people like it. But apparently, now the town of Bolton has two new exports. Tragedy and a famous author.
The author in the book, started writing at age 14, which Jason Mott, like, that's when he started writing. Mm-hmm. You know, so, I mean, there's so many, you know, like, things out there too. So like it was going to be like I catch that part, like he already had drafted with just the book tour stuff.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that makes sense because you're going to do a loose thing about, you know, like, I get that, but I just think, I don't know.
And it's also, do you think it's maybe, is this something that he maybe struggled with as a person? Like being, like feeling not like an authentic black person? I don't know.
Right.
I mean, yeah, because that's the whole, like when comes back, he's at the end of the book tour, they're coming to Bolton. Mm-hmm. And they basically have like a welcome home parade because he's like a local hero because he's mm-hmm. a famous author like from this very small town. But that welcome home parade interrupts a BLM activist thing. Mm-hmm.
As we turn down the main street leading into town, the young protesters begin to find themselves being supplanted by locals holding up signs that read, "Welcome Home." And those that aren't holding up welcome home signs are holding up copies of Hell of a Book.
Yeah.
A BLM protest, and it takes it over, which yeah. I, you know, is symbolic.
Right.
For him being too, he's in the way. Because he can't just go out there and be with them, be with his people.
Right. Yeah, he wouldn't be away, in the way if he, you know, wasn't awoke. Awoken, so, and that's really at the end, like, I don't know how they contrived, like, you know, his arc, if you will, or whatnot. But, I mean, the one thing that frustrated me, too, like, was, I think, all the Kelly scenes and, like, the whole thing with the mortician. Like, I didn't...
Well, it doesn't go anywhere. It doesn't serve any purpose.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's there, so at the end of the book, he can be like, I should call her back.
Right, right. What about
it happens in the last third of the book. It's not even, or is it maybe a little more than halfway? Like
yeah, about halfway. Yeah. They start intertwining. Right. And so there's just,
but it's very brief. It's a very brief thing. And then he mentions like her trying to call him on the plane and he's like happy that he can't get in touch with her. Cause he's on
he's going to send her a text on a plane. That was like the chapter title. Like, you know,
yes.
I miss you. A hell of a thing to say to somebody or something. So
yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, that didn't go anywhere, and I was like a little annoyed, like after the fact with that, like what was that, or is that part of the distraction of like following this guy that you're going to be just as aloof and haste as he is himself, right? Just following that. So I didn't know. What'd you think about the Nick Cage airplane?
Nope. I'm not going through this book to find this clip. You can imagine it though. Just listen to the words. Put it in your mind's eye. Just do it. It was another one of those things you're like, okay. A little cringy. A little cringe.
It does seem like a Nick Cage thing to do, though. To reach across the aisle and be like, I've read your book, and here's where you went wrong. Don't ever talk about this again.
Yeah.
Like, he just came out of the movie. It's about it, like about him or whatever.
Oh, it's coming out soon. It's about him like being himself. He stars mm-hmm. as himself. Yeah.
Yeah. But anyways, I thought that, like I said, it was just really, I'm like, okay. I thought it was kind of fun how every time we referenced him, he used another one of his works, you know, and that was kind of funny. But
I mean, it's not funny. It's just, you're like, oh, I recognize that. That's the joke. The joke is that you recognize it. It's yeah. not a joke. This is like, this is the evil. Remember? Do you remember the fucking Nerdist? Remember like Chris Hardwick?
Oh yeah.
You ever watch At Midnight?
Mm-hmm.
Remember that game show on Comedy Central?
Yeah.
This is what they did to people. They think if you make a reference to a nerdy thing, that's all you got to do. Like, no, this is just like the time Chewbacca went through a car wash, and everybody fucking just laughs.
Mm.
It's the same type of shit. It's just like fuck you. Like, yeah, I get it. Okay, you know, so Chewbacca's wet.
Right,
oh,
right,
Nick Cage is like, he's eccentric. Okay. Oh, so yeah, I recognize that movie. That's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, he asked this guy if he thinks there's Nick Cage marathons in heaven. Okay, I got it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm a hateful person.
So. Yeah. I just don't, so many things didn't land. It felt like a lot of things just didn't connect. Things that are just filler, and I don't know, man.
Well, that's what it feels like. It feels like you feel like even in the moment sometimes, like you're having your time wasted.
Yeah.
And you're like, why? especially after the fact, and especially it was even more egregious when I went through it again to get clips and stuff. Mm-hmm. I was thinking about the parts when I took some notes and wanted to like get some parts, you know, to edit into the podcast here. I was just like, so much of this is like to get to the moment that I was looking for, I'd have to sit through like 4 minutes of like nothing.
Mm-hmm. No, just really, really descriptive in some areas, incredibly vague in others, right? So,
but even
descriptive and non sequiturs and vague in substance. So yeah,
exactly. He really hones in onto these non sequitur things that don't matter.
The interior of Rennie's home is just as stunning as the exterior. Vaulted ceilings, marble tiles, a large kitchen counter that looks as though it was sculpted, not cut, but sculpted, from a single slab of marble. I feel like I've died and gone to capitalist heaven. And maybe I have.
Other than, I guess, is that character stuff? Is that character building stuff?
Right.
Well, I think he seems pretty annoying. I don't know if I want to hang out with that guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Seems like kind of a turd.
Pretty much, man. Pretty much. But was there any... Fuck, man. I think I already asked you this. So... No, I didn't. Was there anything that you liked about it?
I mean, listen. I'm not going to say this is apocalyptically bad. It's not even the worst book I've ever read. I wouldn't say that at all. I would give it a 2 out of 5. It wasn't like I'm not like angry that I experienced it. I might be angry by the time I'm done editing this. But like, I'm not like angry that I listened to it. I don't feel like I totally waste my time. Like I said, I don't read a lot of contemporary fiction, and it has actually made me curious about the quality of modern contemporary fiction.
Well, I didn't go the contemporary fiction route. My next download was Beaten Black and Blue by the officer, Brandon Tatum.
Series brought to you by Beaten Black and Blue. Beaten Black and Blue, being a black cop in America under siege. Make sure you get that book. It's available on Amazon. Also download the podcast, The Beat Tatum Show podcast. Link is in the description section. I think we got like 20 or 30,000 downloads at this point. So I appreciate everybody that have been supporting the podcast. Thank you.
Did you really? You didn't get the Norm Macdonald book?
No, I got that. That's on there too.
Oh yeah, you can't listen to that one at any weird speed though, because Norm Macdonald reads it.
Oh yeah, no, I'm not going to fast forward Norm Macdonald.
No, I mean I read it. I just read the. Oh yeah,
to Norm. To Norm.
I will not eat a single morsel of food until Margaret Thatcher is dead and buried.
She died 3 weeks ago. We'll be.
I actually have never listened to the audiobook. I got the audiobook like months ago because I want to revisit it, but I just read the book. And even when you read the book, you just hear his voice in your head and the pace and the tone.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's really great. It's really great. It's like his version of like Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, actually.
Oh, I love it. Yeah. Love it. Now I'm going to knock that out. I'm going to knock that out too. Well, dude, speaking of which, I'm trying a brand new rye tonight.
Oh, what you got?
Wheel Horse.
Oh, I've seen that. I've seen that around.
Yeah. No, this is right up your alley. So you got that spice of the eye, but it really kicks like a bourbon. And it's still like 101 proof. 50.5%, man. Like, it's good. And under 40 bucks. Under 40 bucks. So.
This is key.
Yeah, that's why I splurged the holidays. Every week I was just getting something I shouldn't have. And now I'm going back to the... Going back to the responsible shelf.
Yeah, but dude, sometimes you like when you do that, when you bust out that $100 for a bottle, and you're like, this is no better than that $30 bottle, man. And it sucks. It's such a bummer when that happens.
That has not happened to me yet. I've never.
It hasn't happened to you yet.
On something where I didn't realize that, like, no, that's good.
It's happened to me twice. It's happened to me when I actually, well, you were there. I bought that $120 bottle of Jameson.
Oh.
It felt like was a complete waste of money. Like I just should have just bought a bottle of Jameson.
Yeah.
And then, what did I get? Oh, it was that place from Utah.
Oh, High West.
High West.
Yeah.
It was like the $80 like.
Oh yeah.
Campfire rye, I think.
Campfire one, yeah.
It was okay. Like it wasn't
It wasn't that much better than like the regular rye.
Yeah, than their double rye.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, then the double
Which rye. Which is my favorite of theirs right now that I've tried is probably the double rye.
Mm. You tried their bourbon, though, right?
I've tried the bourbon. I've tried at least probably like four different variations of their stuff at this point. And it's actually, I give those pretty high marks, the High West stuff.
It's quality, man. It's quality. But hey, I mean, you make a solid under $40 bottle, you know, I'm there.
Man, buddy. I'll be your Huckleberry. Mm-hmm. I'll be your Huckleberry. I mean, I don't know. I mean, like, I wouldn't recommend it, but you know, I could be wrong. You know, maybe I'm just too much of a bigot or something. I don't know.
Yeah. No, I'd love to see a counterpoint.
A real counterpoint, like a real conversation. Mm-hmm. Like all the reviews that I've seen about this, there is no. It is just as substanceless as the book.
No, it just everybody. It just like you know what it is, man. This is just like a white guilt porn for fucking simping like white liberals, man. They're just like all over this dude's dick, and then virtually online texting like dude, one like of the funnest like, oh, things
this is
about
so
this.
Powerful. This is so the most powerful thing I've ever read.
Yeah, I sent you one where the guy's like, it's very although comical, it's very deep, but. What I call it, like, you know, the deep resonance or something. Oh, dude. Like, it's
I don't think I sent it to you. No, I didn't. There was one. It was like, this guy exudes, like, straight guy energy. And he's like, and that made it only okay.
Yeah.
Oh, here we go. This is one of the ones I sent Paul earlier. This is from Goodreads, which is a good place if you want to go just get general overviews of reviews for books, the user reviews and stuff like that. This could probably be called the definitive book on Black Lives Matter.
See,
it gives the most incisive view of what it means to live in today's United States as a person of color through the eyes of both a man and a boy who may or may not be the same person. It doesn't matter how you interpret this. The important thing is you read it.
Yeah. Well, we read it. We read it, man. Hey. It's still not going to. I mean, I'm going to continue my Wheel of Fortune Audible. Wheel of Audible, if you will. I'm going to keep
just, I'm begging you, just like look up a fucking list of like the 100 greatest books ever read. And just go down that list. Stop this madness, Paul. You only have one life. You have one brain, dude, and you're burning brain cells every day. How much longer are you going to be able to read books?
Well,
you got like 10 more years before you're a puddle of slop.
Hey man, 50 minutes. That's gonna be a bitch.
Lucy gave it a rating of 3. She said, "Well, there certainly were some wonderful things about this book, in particular the last section. But overall, I think it needed a bit of editing, as it droned on a bit at times." Okay, surprisingly honest. She closes her review by saying, "And this is an older white woman's perspective."
Oh, because that matters.
Got to qualify it, dude. You can't just like be out there writing reviews.
So when you're reading that review, did you know it was a white woman writing?
I didn't actually, because she didn't have a picture next to her thing. David also gave it 3 stars. He says, "Hell, the book is at times an astute depiction of the threat of state violence faced by black men in the United States. The novel is told in chapters that alternate between the perspectives of an unnamed author and an adolescent black boy called Soot. The chapters featuring Soot are excellent, although they are overshadowed by the main story following the author, which dominate the book. The main story is a bit tedious with too much silliness and a hefty dose of straight man energy." The high points were very good, but getting there wasn't.
What is straight man energy?
Well, you see, he had a lot. Well, I would call it fuckboy energy.
Okay.
You know, the narrator story, that's a fuckboy. You know?
Yeah.
That's a fuckboy. That's a Matt Gaetz running around, coming on everything. But yeah, I don't know. Is this something you're going to suggest to anybody? Maybe your sister, she might like it?
Yeah, you know, my sister might like it, sister and brother-in-law, you know, might do that. They actually live somewhere, nowhere Midwest, right? But, I'll fire it off to them. But no, man. I wouldn't recommend it to anybody. I think my wife might read it because it's on, you know,
it's on Audible.
And I already downloaded that. But,
Oh, hold on. You could go get your credit back.
Oh, dude. After you told me that, after you told me that, I already got the three back. I couldn't part with Talon of God, though, but I got rid of a couple of others.
I got rid of Talon of God. I said, be gone from my life, Talon.
No, I want a reminder of that, so that way I know to check for more fan fiction updates or if another one's coming out.
That's true.
Because like we said when we did
Talon of God. Oh, dude, that's what we got to do. You got to shoot me that fan fiction so we can review that one of these times.
Oh, man. That was fun. That was fun.
It was a fun one.
Yeah. But I just another thing. I just wish I had something, you know, more positive, Sam. Because now I'm feeling like how I felt like after I read this book. I was like, I was irritated and just depressed a bit. Not by topical, but just as the overall delivery, the performance.
It's depressing that like the reaction of to this is kind of what depresses me because like this is the definitive tome for this time period, this ephemeral. Just kind of basic bitch like perspective on the world. It's just it's not very insightful or interesting, even in any direction. In any direction, it's not that insightful.
Right.
Even say if this was like written and the narrator ends up being like a crazy militant person, becomes really militant. He joins the Black Panthers or something. I'd probably have more respect for it. Because it wouldn't be so milquetoast or whatever. It's just like somebody, he had like a list of current events, what's going on around the world, like some topics. It's like he's checking boxes.
Yeah.
And I hate that. And I really
as deep as it got, it was just referencing it, right?
Yes.
Like, especially that Sapphire was talking about, like, you know, like Sid's father, like, you know, I don't want to tell him, you know, I don't want in relation to discovering about another shooting, like, you know, why did that person get shot? What did they do? And he's like, well, it's important we find out the facts and whatnot. Then the overall thing, like, no, he doesn't want to tell them why. Like, and just this bullshit, like, assumption, like, it's all, like, you know, just, like, there's no two sides of, like, of every story and, like, you know, just this negative lens, you know, and there's just, like, no appreciation of just, like, how far, you know, it has come. Like, because mind you, this, you know, Black author in the novel is a bestseller and touring around the country. So it's very terrible for him, but is he touring around the country because he, you know, went to sleep, so to speak, in a, you know, metaphorical sense with, you know, hiding it in based off, you know, Jack the Meteor's train. Cause they had that cringe part where he's talking to Rennie, like, I am Black.
And what do you think about it, State College? You're a writer. You're supposed to say something about these things. And you're Black. Am I? I ask. I look down at my arm, and sure enough, it turns out that Rennie is right. I'm Black. A startling discovery to make this far along. Well now, I say, staring at the black hand at the end of my black arm and the black fingers adorning it. That's very, very interesting.
He Black.
Am I? Because the first time he sees that BLM protest, right?
And well, that's what he said. He's like, this may seem like a startling revelation this far into a story. But yes, I am in fact Black.
Mm-hmm. It was just like, really, man? And then he goes back, all right, let's pause for a minute. It's literally the title of the next chapter following that. And it goes into where you get introduced to, you know, Jack the Media Trainer. So, and we talked about it earlier, but like, that's what they do. Like, okay, don't write this. You know, book sells, blah, blah, blah. But, and then. Then he goes in and takes on that, just like a Humphrey Bogart character. Well, let's just fully go into that.
Yeah.
So I don't just talk like him. Now I'm going to look like him to go back in life. I'm going to block everything out into a complete haze, into my own devices. And
well, you know, I think what you said, like saying that movie. What movie did you reference?
Sorry to Bother You.
Sorry to Bother You. I think that's like a good comparison or parallel. Well, I can acknowledge that I think Sorry to Bother You is like – well paced and it feels like you should be having fun. It's a very snappy movie. I think it has an odious message.
That movie's like a shitty song where you're like, well, it sounds awesome.
Yeah, but this has a similar quality because it's just surface. It's the surface.
Yeah.
It's the surface. It's like a teenager's version. Like actually that's something I thought about when I was reading this or listening to it. And I kind of cringed at myself a little bit. I was like, oh, I probably would have thought something like this idea for a story would have been very cool when I was 14.
Right.
oh, dude, yeah, he's crazy. He can't, like, differentiate between his fantasy and reality. And you see his dead kids, and they haunt him, and he's getting drunk, and he's crazy all the time. Like, that's what you would have thought of maybe when you were 15 or 16, 14, thinking about what would be, like, a cool adult story.
Right, right.
Or probably because I saw Fight Club when I was 12, and how can I just rip off Fight Club?
Yeah. Which there's nothing wrong with, like, ripping off people you love. You know, so flattery is the best imitation.
Yeah,
form
sure.
Power,
but, yeah.
But, you know.
It's nice if you do it well.
Yeah, but that's the thing. That's the thing. You're going to rip me off, you know, do a good job with it, you know. Do a good job with it so that way I can see your ass. But yeah. Dude, I'm never going to not do Will of Audible again. And as soon as I did it, it just popped in my head, man. Because I was talking about something else, another topic, and I was just going to shoot. You could have said no, man. Okay, then I would have went on to, and I would have been on to my.
No, I actually, I know, in its own weird way, like, I do appreciate it because it does expand your horizons. Like, you see a little bit what's out there. Mm-hmm. There are lots of times I feel very out of touch with contemporary culture.
Yeah,
I don't watch a lot of, like, new TV shows or anything right. like that, so I'm, like, really out of the loop with a lot of stuff. And honestly, it was just kind of interesting to read something that would be considered in the modern purview like this is a great book.
Right.
Like an important smash hit.
Right, right.
Which I don't know. I wonder what the book sales are like for this. I don't know. But I don't know. It's got a lot of reviews. It's got 933 written reviews, 5,497 ratings. And Goodreads, I believe, is connected to Amazon. So these are probably Amazon purchasers. And they're the biggest seller of books in the country.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even know what's considered like a smash book these days.
Not me neither. No,
like, unless you're somebody like Jordan Peterson or something where you have like this huge international crossover and you sell, you know, 50 million books or something.
Right.
That's in most authors that like make a living, they sell like 20 to 50,000 copies of their books. They don't sell like a ton of copies.
Yeah. Well, but anyways, man, I'm glad you read it with me.
Well, you know, I'm glad you suggested it. It was a fun conversation. Here's to Soot.
Soot. Nick Cage. Here's Nick Cage.
Here's Nick Cage. May he live on in eternity in the narrator's second book.
Here we go.
That we won't read. Anyways, all right, thanks, Paul. I appreciate it, buddy.
Oh, thank you, buddy.
And thank you all out there for listening, for watching, all that good stuff. There's a bunch of stuff in the description. If you want to go check it out there, you are more than welcome to. This has been Zoobox Goes to the Library. Thanks for joining us. And we'll see you next time. Who knows what we'll talk about next time? Who knows what the Wheel of Audible will present to us? Sick fuck. All of the greatest works of art, the greatest literature known to man at his fingertips at any given time. And he's over there randomly scrolling like a psycho because it gets him off.
Some would say the road less traveled, good buddy.
It gets this guy off. He's sick. Mm-hmm. He needs the excitement.
Who doesn't, man? Who doesn't? It spiced up your life.
Yeah, that's true.
And it spiced up your life.
Hell of a book, man. Hell of a book. Good night, everybody.
He black.